It's the Forensic Lunch. I'm Dave.
And I'm Matthew.
And we have a great show for you today. I'm just going to do this again because this worked really well last time. And it's much better than awkwardly trying to move around my laptop when I'm screaming with. Today's broadcast, we're live from Enfuse, which is great. Thanks again to Guidance for giving us the space and the internet access to do it. We know it's not cheap for either in this venue. And our first guest today is Steve Whalen.
Yeah, Steve Whalen from Sumori.
Is that how you say it?
Yeah, it's Sumori. It's a Tagalog word.
So I kept saying Sumori.
Yeah, it just goes along with everything. It's Sumori. It's a Tagalog Filipino word.
Do me a favor. Pick up the mic.
Got it.
We want to make sure people can hear you. So it's Sumori.
Sumori.
That's important.
Yep.
But Paladin is spelled, say, the normal way.
Yeah, Paladin's the normal one. That's one of the words that's not in the software. It's not Tagalog.
So what does it mean again?
It means to investigate or analyze
really?
In Tagalog.
That's really cool. I had no idea.
Yep.
All right. So you've been on before.
Yes.
We've talked about things before.
Yes.
And you have something new.
Yes.
I like a lot. So let's talk specifically. Well, let's do two things. One, for those who don't know, you've never heard of Sumori, or you've never heard of Paladin or Recon or Carbon or all the other stuff that you've been doing. Tell them a little bit about yourself and your company.
Yeah. So we most of us are law enforcement background. Started company in 2010, Sumori. Most people know us for Paladin Forensic Suite, which we go out to the world for free or for donations, which our programmers like to eat every once in a while. Mm-hmm. So, then what we try to do here with this, what we're going to talk about in a second, is just next evolution of Paladin, so I'll talk about that in a minute. But the rest of us, we just do hardware with the Tilinos, the software, services, training, all that good stuff. Yeah. Mostly known for Mac stuff.
Yeah, I know. A lot of Mac stuff.
Yes.
And so you specifically have a new Mac thing right here in front of you.
Yes. It was well needed, so we made it.
So let's talk about it.
So this is actually, it's kind of hard to see. I know we got a fixed camera, but it's Recon Imager. It's, again, if you can...
grab
it. Oh, no, it's all right.
No, let's...
Okay. It is a...
Yeah, just put it in front of it. We didn't really think about how to do screen sharing, so instead we're going to do... very rudimentary screen sharing to show the interface.
Ooh,
real quick.
Pretty. everybody's got colors.
This is amazing, isn't it?
That's it. It's got an adapter.
It does.
All the Apple products need right now.
Wait, hold that pose.
Wonderful Apple.
So let's awesome. Talk. Thanks, Brandon.
That's good.
That was amazing.
You should say thanks, Vanna.
This is real screen sharing software.
Yes, that's his. When all else fails, human okay. automation.
So I'll get into this real quick. So think Paladin Pro. So Paladin Pro is a product that we do sell for $75, more like a fundraising type thing. Has all versions of Paladin on it. So 64-bit, 32-bit, mm-hmm. and then the full-blown one with all the open source forensics tools, which again, we give out to the world and try to keep it updated as much as possible. Mm-hmm. New versions are coming out. But the problem is it's based on Ubuntu, it's a Linux kernel,
yep.
so it doesn't always support the Mac hardware all the time.
Right.
And I know we do... people like Paladin and like to use it's free, but we keep running into that issue. So we had to go with the native Mac OS, which I know there's other products out there, but then there are some limitations as well mm-hmm. with hardware. So we want to have something that comes out that supports all Intel Macs and actually is a really good price point.
Yeah.
Core storage is totally natively supported.
Nice.
It supports Fusion, FileVault, obviously. And an important thing about that is if you have a two-disk Fusion drive and it's not interpreted
correct
through the Mac OS.
Correct.
And you image them separately, they're not going to work in any forensics tool in the market right now.
Because they were never meant to be seen that way.
Yeah. So you have to use the Mac in some shape or form. It has to be in the equation.
Yep.
So you can either image them first with like Paladin and do individual disk images,
right.
recombine them on the Mac and then image again, or just image ahead of time with something like this,
right.
and then actually have it one format that fits into all forensics tools.
Now. So this solves a big issue that a lot of people have, and we actually have conversations about this all the time, which is, what the hell are you doing for Mac imaging? And and there's kind of two ways to do it, right? There's two answers. Well, there's three. You have the people that are doing live imaging,
mm-hmm.
and that works, and you can get a DD or whatever else that you're
yep.
doing and run on a disk. But I mean, it's you don't always want to do a live image on a Mac.
Not if you can help it.
Yeah, not if you can help it. You have the people that are doing the targeted disk mode still with FireWire or Thunderbolt.
Which is scary because you have to be careful with write blockers if you're connected to another system because of the EFI or EFI system partition.
And so this is something that's very real people need to understand. If you're using targeted disk mode, it is not write protected. And this is more interesting now because you're going to have, possibly if it's boot camped, Windows may directly start writing to the second volume. If you're using another Mac, it's going to see a Mac volume attached.
Exactly.
So a lot of people think just because, you know, it's there and exposed and, you know, we recommend it as a way to access disks that somehow this is some kind of protected media.
Back in the old days, it's perpetuated over time it's HFS, Windows doesn't care, connect to your system, image it, which is fine, but again, the ESP...
Yep.
Or the EFI system partition, and then also, you know, anything that's boot camped, unless you have X-ray vision, you don't know.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard to, it's like playing Russian roulette.
Well, exactly.
Raptor was the big one back in the day for Mac stuff, right?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know what happened to Raptor.
Let me tell you about it. It was mine.
It was yours?
Raptor was with my old company before Discovery.
Whoa, I never even knew that.
Yeah, so what happened was is the rest of the members from our team, once we dissolved for Discovery, they went with Alvarez & Marshall.
Yep.
So they kept it and it hasn't been updated in a while.
Interesting. Okay, well, it answers my question of what happened to Raptor.
So basically, Paladin is the evolution of Raptor.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when I started some more.
Yeah. I really did like Raptor a lot.
Yeah,
yeah, it was cool.
Yeah. Well, and of course, my first introduction to your work was when you used to have that website with all the little in-case tips and tricks and different forensic stuff. So that's when I first was reading your stuff back when you were a detective, Steve Whalen.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah, way back in the day. Stay away from listservs.
So you might be surprised how much you've used Steve's stuff in the past. You just not realized it.
Yeah.
Fixes the two problems we just talked about.
Right. So it supports all Intel Macs. Like we have actually, it's a quintuple boot environment.
Nice.
So it's got three versions of Paladin, two versions of native Mac OS, one for the older Macs, one for the newer Macs. Mm-hmm. This supports everything up, even the little touch bar thingy.
Mm-hmm.
And then it also has a RAM imager, which is kind of cool as well.
Yeah.
So with that, I'm just going to say, if you're able to do a quick restart, not shut down power back on, but a quick restart, you can get a lot of content from the previous RAM session.
Which is
some amazing things.
Fascinating. You know, there's been other studies on similar things, right? So there is a researcher who said, hey, if I quickly pull out a RAM stick and plug it into another system, there's a chance I can get something. But... this is definitely something that people should be looking into.
Yeah, so I put a little post on the listserv not too long ago on one of the listservs, a forensic listserv for law enforcement.
Yep.
And once I realized what was there, I was like, oh, call me before.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
There's some interesting things. I'll put it that way.
All right. Now, you can solve a lot of your Mac issues. It supports everything from the MacBook, new Air, to the new touchpad,
everything,
all the things in between.
Intel Mac.
Yep. And this one actually comes now. This is the old form factor. I'm pointing at the USB drive.
Yes.
But you're also coming out with one with a new form factor, which I think is more convenient.
Yeah, so we were trying to stay away from moving parts. But and everybody seems to like these drives for our Paladin Pro drives.
Yeah.
But and they're waterproof, so you can use them in a pool.
That's always been a problem for me.
Just in case. But then, so there are USBs out there that actually have a Type-C and a Type-A adapter on it, so that you don't need, all the Apple adapters and such. But... we were trying to stay away from moving parts because that tends to break. But,
correct.
We found some things that we like, and we're probably going to move to that a little bit later.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. So now we don't want to talk about that yet.
Oh, it's coming. It's coming.
Well, I mean, the fact that it has a Type-C adapter.
Oh, you can.
Okay.
Yeah, Type-C,
I just
Type-A.
Did.
Yeah, you did. Switch, Type-C, Type-A.
So if you're dealing with the newer Macs where there's no real USB port, it can become a pain if you have these bootable USB drives and literally nothing to plug them into.
So, but I can if plug here, not no money for this, but you can go to Amazon.
Yeah.
There's some good all-key adapters for two for 10.
But it's one more thing you have to travel with.
It's one more thing, and then you lose them really easily.
Really easy to lose them.
Yes.
So that's why I really, when you showed that to me, I thought it was really cool that you could just flip it, and all of a sudden you can plug into either, and it works on both sides.
Yes.
That's really nice. DFR guy says, and another cool tool I learned today, adding to DFR training Recon Imager.
Awesome.
Now, this is a commercial product.
Yes, it is.
So make sure we're clear about this. Paladin, by itself, there is a free version.
Yeah, so it's donationware, Paladin.
It'd be really nice if people donated so Steve keeps able to do it.
Yeah, we do it for free. it comes out of our pocket. So
whatever
you can contribute, mostly for law enforcement, but corporate benefits from it as well.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, so... and then this actually, we have to eat and pay bills and conference expenses.
It's not cheap.
So, can I mention the price?
Please.
$399. So, not $3.99, like $399.
So $399 gets you the actual USB drive.
USB drive.
Gets you all the image distros. And lets you able to boot up into a safe forensics environment to be able to image all modern Macs.
Yes. Plus all the Paladin stuff.
Plus all the Paladin. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, I can't do anymore.
Let's see. It could come on a 4 terabyte drive so I can image back to the disk. No, I mean,
we could do that. So.
The all-in-one.
Yeah. A little bit more money, I'll come out and do the forensics for you. So that's what we can include with it. That's an upgrade.
But no, I think it solves a big problem, and it's probably the one most common question you'll see in listservs now is what the F do I do with this Mac?
Yeah, we've been planning to do this for quite a long time. It's just that we've been busy with other products and other teaching, training,
for sure,
and stuff
you have,
like that.
Yeah.
And it's a need for it. Like, we want to keep the price down low so that it's affordable. It's just an imager, you know. So we give around Paladin for free or donationware. Mm-hmm. But again, so when we added the native Mac support, it's again something that's reasonable to help everybody out.
Very cool. Very cool. Anything else you wanted to talk about today, or?
I've been having some personal problems sleeping, but aside from that, I'm good. Something to do with too much work.
Yeah, I can understand that.
Oh, Sarah!
Sarah's excited about USB-C Recon.
Oh, awesome. Thanks, Sarah.
Yeah, it's a thing.
Yeah, I love her.
No, I mean USB-C. Having a forensic bootable distro that actually has USB-C is a huge thing for the new Macs.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Will do. It'll get there.
Did you want to talk about your team or all, how the company's growing? Or?
Oh, yeah. We're adding more people every day. It's it's growing fast. The Tolinos are like, oh, my gosh, they're like just flying off the shelves. You know, we're happy. Thank you for all of our Tolino owners. Yep. That's awesome. Manny and the team are doing a great job with that.
Yep.
I got a lot of new software coming out. That's kind of new reorganization, and it'll be good. There'll be some neat things coming out later.
And it's
Sumori.
Sumori.com.
Yes, exactly. Sumuri.com.
And so for those watching the recording, it's going to be down below. For everybody else, type quick.
Yep. All right. Well, thanks for having me on.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you.
See you guys.
Yeah, definitely Paladin. I'm a big fan of it.
It saved my butt multiple times.
We use it quite often. especially if you're a student, I think using bootable CDs is a good experience for a student. It's something you can do for free because they're freely available, and you can practice with them, image some stuff with them. We started off in class with Helix, and that was way back in the day.
Yep.
And so Paladin was...
Well, I mean, there's been a lot of different distros over the years, and most of them have fallen off in terms of support and community development.
Yeah. There was also, let's see, there's Kali, there was...
Kane.
There's all sorts of them, but they're definitely useful.
They're useful, so, and a lot of times there were originally like some kind of grant that funded them or a government contract or, you know, someone thought it was good for the company and then things broke up and... They just kind of wither away, and then all of a sudden you have this distro that no longer is able to do what she needed to do.
Yeah, the DARPA Cyber Fast Track really contributed to that a lot, right?
Yes, for
where
sure.
People got grant money to build something. They built it using grant money, and then we've never seen an update from it afterwards.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Brett Shavers points out WinFE. Brett, you're absolutely right. Yes. WinFE is great when it's not a Mac.
Well played, sir.
No, I mean, seriously, like every tool has its purpose, right?
Yeah.
And so what we were just talking about is great, especially, you know, we were dealing with weird Macs that, you know, we use Paladin all the time. But WinFE, if I'm dealing with a Windows system and it's dealing with something weird or I need a little specific RAID drivers or I need to look up certain type of BitLocker support or something else, WinFE is absolutely my go-to option in those cases.
Oh, agree. Totally.
Yeah.
I will never, I don't want to say never. Never say never, right? But seriously, when it comes to rebuilding RAIDs, there is never a good... I just said never again. Don't, in general, one should not image individual drives and then go try to rebuild.
No.
That is a what we like to call a losing proposition.
Absolutely.
A
place for everything. Everything has its place. Absolutely, Brett. Agreed.
Yeah, totally.
And it's funny you say that. You know, I've had a couple people, and they're like, so you have these RAID discs. What did you do? And I'm like, well, I got the same exact RAID controller, and I plugged them back in.
That is exactly it. Exactly, right?
Because that way you can read the header and figure out what the drive order was.
Oh, I mean...
There's so many variables.
Any number of... Yeah, totally. Yeah. Totally. Yep. We pulled a box apart last year, actually. It was a Dell It's one of these weird, it was Dell branded, but it was a box that they had bought from like some other no-name, you know, had been in the market for a year or two. Yeah. And we ended up having to get, basically the client didn't know the password to it. It was an IT case where the IT admin had gone ape, you know the deal, right? We actually had to pull, we found a little USB header that was actually on the, you know, on the box, and we had to pull that off and get that image and go break into that and reset the passwords there. There was a lot of reverse engineering work. Zero documentation on this.
Of course,
right? And even you call Dell and they're like, yeah, we don't really make that anymore. And we don't really support that at all.
Yeah, good luck, buddy.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. We don't even know who originally built it, kind of thing. It's
my favorite is when people say, oh, I have a RAID, and really it's just RAID 0.
Yep, that's another great one, too.
So, Jake, how are you?
Oh, living the dream, man. Always.
So, for those who don't know, this is Mauer Jake.
Hi.
You may have seen him on places such as Twitter.
Such as Twitter.
Many conferences, many places, many things. What have you been up to, Jake?
A lot, actually. It's been a crazy couple of weeks, right? Obviously, Sans got involved with the whole WannaCry malware. And, you know, I hate to even bring that up because I feel like we're getting to the point of like APT, right? When somebody mentions that God kills a kitten.
Yeah, right? Everybody starts flinching.
Yeah, no, totally. I was actually at Interop last week. I spoke there, and I'm walking through the vendor hall, and this dude stops me, and he's like, do you know what would have stopped WannaCry? Well, he's got a big banner behind him that says WannaCry, kind of like an LCD thing. And I'm like, I said, no, tell me more. And he says, administrative permissions. If your users didn't have admin, that would stop the spread. And
I've seen people say this.
I said, I'm sorry? What do you mean? And he's like, oh, well, the problem was all the users were local admins. And I said, I don't think you know how this works. He's like, and then he says to me, he says, do you know who I am? And I'm like, no, I don't. But
are you willing to say who he was?
I'll leave the vendor out of it. But he's like, I invented this IAM software. I'm like, surprise, you provide the solution for the very problem that you've made up. Excellent. Good job, sir. Right? So anyway. Yep. It was, there's so much play there. The thing that we've kind of come to is that we know that there's people that are not going to update.
Yeah.
Right? And can't update, whether it's medical devices, manufacturing devices, you name it. Before this came out, we were actually in I think it was IT World or PC World or who knows, some publication, where we talked about segmenting networks to stop this, right? Because at the time, we said, look, you're never getting a patch for Windows Server 2003.
You shouldn't have gotten a patch for Windows Server 2003.
I mean, you know, that's an interesting topic. We haven't really discussed this.
No, we haven't.
I honestly think Microsoft did a disservice by providing the patch for XP.
See,
Server 2003, I'm in a different platform or a different kind of mindset on.
I disagree only because it was such, I mean, when you have a worm.
Yes.
It changes the rules.
I both get it, and then at the same time, I step back, and I know that there are people. So when 2014-1776, you remember this? Right after XP stops patching, 2014-1776 comes out, and Microsoft says, bam, here's this one-time exception we're going to make. And I had clients that canceled their XP migration plans right then and there. They said,
absolutely.
If another big, wormable, bad, whatever, you know, cataclysmic vulnerability comes out for XP, they're going to provide a patch.
But,
and
let's be honest.
Roll four or 3 years, and they did.
No question. But if support has been over for this long, and they're willing to live with that risk, they're not going to do it anyway.
Well, touche. I guess that's a good point, right? Touche. Yeah. Right? So look, for Server 2003, I'm down with that.
Yeah.
That makes perfect sense. I've got lots of clients that can't get rid of it. We understand. We actually wrote a tool called Tier Stopper. It's available on the website.
Absolutely.
We're pushing a new update to that tomorrow with a bunch of new, because there's a bunch of new mutexes floating around with different variants.
Yep.
We're pushing an update for that tomorrow. One of the things we committed to do was to keep it up to date. And people leave their emails. We leave them on the email list to say, hey, I thought about having like an auto update, but that feels creepy to me. Right? It's like this, as soon as you get into that, oh, am I not on the mic? Sorry, here I was talking.
No,
you're
talking good. It's just I want to make sure your volume is loud enough.
Ah,
people
totally,
can hear you.
Yeah. But I wanted to do an auto update, but then I realized that seems creepy, like stalkery kind of deal.
Yes and no, right? I mean, if your auto update saves their butt.
Well, so as we thought about this a little bit, and I thought about that too, right? But I think kind of where I was at was the majority of places, as I look at the risk model, the majority of places that you would want to deploy this, where you say, I can't patch, should not be able to talk directly to the internet. Hence, auto update doesn't work.
Agreed.
All right, so
agreed.
Anyway, we're pushing a service-based version, code signed, all the normal, you know, ready-to-go stuff, and updating the mutexes, so that should be fun. But, I say fun, right? It's not fun for anybody, but at least with the goal being to help immunize the community a little bit. And again, we've got a ton of these medical, particularly folks that work in medicine, right?
Yes.
Laboratory equipment that is never, ever, ever going to be updated because the risk of updating it is just too high.
Right.
Whereas you can run this, it's got a zero memory footprint. I mean, like 68K memory footprint, and there's no risk to the machine.
I mean, we're talking MRI scanners. We're talking diagnostic machines. We're talking, I mean, there's a large variety of medical equipment where a hospital spends a crap ton of money and it's functional, and they're not just going to replace it because suddenly they need to upgrade to a new version of Windows.
Yeah. Now, we worked with a laboratory company a couple of years ago, and I was blown away by the scale because I see the name, and I'm thinking, obviously we won't talk about company name, right? But I see the name, and I'm like, oh, you guys do blood tests. I remember seeing an invoice from you on my insurance form, right?
Yep.
And so we're there, and I'm in the office, like corporate office, and they're like, hey, want to go to the lab? And I'm like, who doesn't want to go to the lab?
Yeah.
I'm like, are there rare diseases there? And they're like, no. But I'm like, well, I took a bunch of the fun out of it. We go there, and there are semi-trailers backing up to a loading dock, right? And they are unloading blood vials by the crate with forklifts.
Wow.
Right? And you step back then, and there's a sudden realization about the scope and scale of this equipment.
Yep.
That when that goes down, these overnight tests that the doctors are depending on and the whole...
It all falls
this
down.
Totally changes. Obviously, these aren't the stat tests. Stat, do it now type thing you see on ER or Grey's Anatomy. But these are the... Not necessarily routine, right?
Yeah.
But there's somebody who's depending on these results and then being correct, right?
Yeah.
So, it kind of puts it back in the scale a little bit or in perspective, right?
Mm-hmm.
For what you're really dealing with there when we talk about availability.
So. Well, and it's easy if you live in a kind of a modern environment with a company that has a good architecture to kind of look down upon those that are stuck with. You know, a legacy system that they're stuck with, and you think in your head like, oh, well, they could get rid of this. Like, you know, there's no excuse for this, and that's just not true.
Oh, no. And you know, I'll actually say, Dave, is you bring that up, and one, you're right, that's absolutely not true. The other thing I'll say is that I'm working with clients today that were looking down on people like, oh, look at your puny XP. We've deployed Server 2008.
Yeah.
Right, which is rolling up. It's going to roll up on end of life, and they do not have, when you ask, what is your migration plan, because it will take you. Years to get this set up, right? Have you tested your software on Server 2012? They're like, we have, and it doesn't work. And it's like, gotcha, right? Because you're going to be stuck on this now too, right? It's easy to say. It's whatever you build tends to be the...
Well, it's not like that, but Server 2012 is like the bad version of Windows 8 for servers.
Oh, well, not only... I mean, look, great. Yeah, and so go ahead and tell me Server 2016, but now we get into some serious licensing costs, right?
Well, not only licensing...
The whole licensing model changes.
But you also have to deal with the new single instance storage model. And everything gets jacked up if it's looking at the disk, right?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
yeah. There's so much there that's really, really dangerous from for an upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
And then as we get into an incident response and forensic standpoint,
yeah.
what this means for you and I is that, you know, I think back to what I like to call the good old days, right? where I had when we talk about Windows, right?
Yeah.
It's XP, Windows 2000, NT4, NT351, and that was kind of it, right? I mean, it's a rare day when somebody's like, here's my Windows for Workgroups 3.11. Please forensicate this box.
It's been a while.
But even in the old days, it really didn't happen a lot. People hadn't built critical systems on those in general. And I look at this, and I'm still doing Windows 3.51 boxes today, NT351.
Oh, I haven't seen one of those in a while.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah, no.
Oh, okay. So I've... anyway.
That's some serious legacy.
Clearly, I need different clients. Anyway, But no, seriously. So what it means for us, I think, as forensicators, is that... As with every new version of the operating system, the Windows operating system that comes out, we are going to have to not only learn that, but keep up our skills on some ever-growing tail of, you know, operating systems that are now out of support, but are still used in critical infrastructure or critical business process, whatever. And as a result, again, when our clients call, we're going to have to know how to forensicate those as well as everything else. You think about like some of the stuff that we rely on for a lot of our cases, AmCache, right? ShimCache.
Yep.
And you roll back into Windows 2000 and you're like, oh, wah, right?
I had somebody call me with a Windows 98A.
Wow.
And they're
Windows 98A.
is there any USB tracking? I'm like, well, USB isn't enabled. I mean, you had to wait for B for that. And they're like, oh. Yeah.
I had a case 2 years ago with an open VMS system, right? So as you talk about, like, you know, this is, you know, it's actually running on an old DEC Alpha.
Yep.
Right? I mean, you look at this and you're like, where did you even find this thing, right? Let alone you're running, well, it doesn't matter. It's critical infrastructure. Well, not business. I mean, actual, no joke, critical infrastructure running on this thing. And you're like, I don't know how this passes. When was the last time you updated? And you roll back and you're like, oh, nobody published updates for that for the last 6 years. Yeah. And you have it exposed to the internet.
Yep.
Go you.
Why wouldn't you?
Of course. right, totally. So.
Now, I think the one that we keep getting that's always a pain in the butt is when you get an old AIX system running JFS1 and they use what IBM tries to call a RAID, but it's really just like 9 disks that are like in a polyamorous relationship.
That is so going on Twitter.
The data just being spread around for no rhyme or reason.
It's not a RAID. It's 9 disks in a polyamorous relationship.
That's the best description I can.
That is outstanding.
Because what it does to you.
Oh, totally. Totally. And that's why I'm starting to lose my hair, right? Yeah. I mean, totally. Yep. Anyway, so.
So, your Rendition InfoSec is your company.
Rendition InfoSec, definitely.
And it's going strong.
So far, we can't complain. We actually have a 24/7 SOC running now.
Now, this we should talk about.
What's that?
This we should talk about. Okay, we have not talked about this.
We should talk about this, yeah.
So, as you've told me, and I was like, what? Explain what you've done.
Explain what I've done.
Explain
what you've done. What have you done? You fool! Right? So, look, increasingly, we're running into clients in the small, medium enterprise market, right? So the SME market, where they have a lot of trouble with procurement, right? Like, our number one challenge getting in the door, they need a service, they know they have huge problems in procurement. And they're coming back to us and saying, yeah, I did great for incident response, and we know we need monitoring. We heard you loud and clear. Our system admins clearly can't do it, right? And let me come back to that in a minute about system admins doing log monitor. Remind me if I forget. but seriously, you know, they come back and say, we know our system admins can't do it, and, you know, hey, we want to use somebody, right? But to say, you know, whoever we pick for that, we're going to need to do incident response as well and pen testing. And they're trying to do this all in one package. They're like, we don't care if you sub it out. Right, but we need you to do it as one contract. We only want to pay one organization.
Yeah, exactly.
And so the procurement challenges kind of came in, and we said, meh, I finally bit the bullet. I looked at a lot of the other managed security service providers.
And there are many.
And I just wasn't happy, right? And this isn't a knock on anyone either. You know, some of them were price. Many of them were total lack of performance and competence, as we well know, right?
Yep.
And so I just bit the bullet and went ahead and did it. So so far, I haven't regretted it yet. Talk to me next year, and you know, I'll tell you whether or not. Depends on how much sleep I'm getting, right?
Yeah.
So coming back on the log thing, right? Yeah. Frequently, one of the things I hear during an incident response, and I'm sure you hear this as well, particularly when there's a regulatory requirement, HIPAA, or you name an insert regulatory requirement, or HIPAA is the most common one that I end up dealing with most often, and you say, PCI too. Obviously, how could I forget? Actually, never mind. I lobotomize that part of my brain, so I never have to think about PCI again. But, you know, you say, are you doing daily log review? And they're like, oh, totally. And I say, well, what are you looking for, right?
Disk failures.
I find this is best if I've got, like, you know, some senior leadership in the room and you're talking to the admin.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You don't want to be I'm going to come off sounding like an evil person, and I'm not. It just comes down to kind of working through and saying,
well,
because
they're going to lie to you.
What's that?
They'll lie to you otherwise.
Well, of course they're lying to you, right? And so you say, you know, what are you looking for? And they're like, oh, hackers. And I'm like, cool. And one of the things that I like to do, and people get mad at me when I use my mom as the stereotypical person that doesn't know computers, but she'll tell you she doesn't, right? She's a nursing administrator, runs a nursing home in Virginia, a veterans home actually in Virginia. She doesn't know anything about computers, horrible. And I say, look, I'm going to get my mom on the phone, and I want you to explain to her what you're looking for in the logs. I want you to explain to her how to find a hacker.
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, whoa, that's time out. That's ridiculous, right? And I say, okay, well, let's back up for a minute then. Let me get I've got a system admin over at another company I work with, and he's trying to do the same thing you're doing, but they're not nearly as mature. They're not actually doing the log
monitoring.
Yeah,
they're not as good
as
you are. Yeah.
Let me put you on with him. He's a system admin. He has a similar skill set. Yeah. You can explain to him how to find the hackers, right? Oh, my goodness. That's when you get a lot of stumble, well, I do log review, but I'm looking for, you know, signs of compromise. And it's like, cool, again, what are those, right? And you start working through this, and I challenge any CIO out there, no joke.
Yep.
Walk in, do the same exercise. Ask your admins if they tell you they're doing daily logging, particularly if you have a regulatory requirement.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Talk to the admins and say, what are you looking for? Because if they can't tell you, even if you believe that they're actually doing the log review and don't believe them, they're lying to you, right? Seriously, right? They don't even know what they're looking for, short of an actual event log coming out and saying, hacker was here,
right?
You're totally toast. So,
well, I mean, let's talk about, you know, what I find to be true a lot of the times, which is you need to have multiple terrible things happen before your company matures enough to actually ensure that that kind of discipline is there and required and that somebody's checking on it.
Yep.
And if you're working in a company now where nothing bad has happened yet, then no one's doing it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, we worked a great case with, and this is another one, you know, we talked to folks in the kind of the sphere of cyber threat intelligence, kind of rolling into deeper, you know, digital forensics. And we worked with a client, and they said, basically, we were in there for a ransomware event, right? So it was a fairly common, you know, like, commodity kind of thing. We paid the Bitcoin. That's one of the things we do. We have a lot of Bitcoin on hand, and we'll pay for clients that get hit and can't establish a Bitcoin wallet because it's hard. And anyway, and so we're in there, and we're like, hey, you guys done some threat hunting or whatever? And, you know, like, oh, yeah, we don't really need to do any of that. And I go on their website, right? And on the front of their website, they've got a big press release up, and they're like, signed biggest contract in the history of our company with, wait for it, some province in China, some governmental province in China. And I'm like, dude, just out of curiosity, right, how'd those negotiations go? And the guy's like, well, it was very competitive. We made a short list, and then after that, the bidding was ultra competitive on the short list of five. And I was like, did it seem like they almost knew your talking points? And he's like, it was very, very competitive. Like, he said, they really eked us to within an inch of our profit margin. And I'm like, oh, yeah. No, I'm sure they did. I have zero doubt in my mind that they rolled right up to the edge of where you could remain profitable. And then you signed the contract. And they're like, yeah. The guy's like, how did you know? And I'm like, I'm psychic, right?
Yes.
And he's like, seriously? I said, no, because you did business with China, right? And as you start doing these, and I'm not saying this as like, it's always China, right?
No, it's other countries as well.
There's other countries as well. India's another great one, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
And so, as you start looking at France, as you start Spain, anyway, so Germany, as you start working through some of these countries, right, that you're starting to do business with or for or competing with some of their own national, you know, nationalized-ish brands, you can expect this. Forget you can. You should expect this stuff to happen.
Yeah.
And again, be on the lookout for. And you know, again, if you're not increasing your security posture as you're increasing your risk posture, think about walking down a dark alley, right? Start walking down a dark alley, I pull the phone out, kind of make sure the light's on, pre-dial 911. You know the deal, right? You're increasing your risk posture, you're increasing your security. If you're increasing your risk posture in business and not increasing your security, woe is you, right? Anyway, so, yeah. Sorry for the rant.
Well, the thing is, and here's something I think people forget, is that we always talk about all these external foreign actors.
Oh, yeah.
But we have had cases, I'm sure you have as well, where the domestic threat is also there. And we have, you know, companies within the U.S. that are doing the same thing to each other.
Oh,
the only
totally.
Difference is that we can actually sue them.
Right. You know, Alan Powler said it best, right, when he talked about cyber espionage. And he said, look, if you're a, and I'm going to misquote him here, I'm sure, but the meat of the quote generally rolls. He said, you know, if you're a company today, if you're in organized crime, if you are trying to make a profit and you are not involved in cyber espionage, you should be sued for malpractice. And I think that there's something to that, right? Now, by the way, first off, Alan Powell runs SANS. SANS does not encourage you to go do cyber espionage against your competitors, right?
But that new class is coming next year.
That new class comes next year. That's something like jail 660 or something, right? Where you go directly to prison, do not pass go, for like $200. But you get the idea, right? I mean, you know, as folks with less than great moral backing, right? Come in, they're going to do this. It's just reality. So anyway. Yeah, definitely.
Yep.
So,
very cool.
Yeah.
What else is going on with you?
Well, I'm flying to Madrid next week. That's
really
going to be awesome. I mean, I'm doing incident response for SANS out in Madrid, and then I follow up the next week with threat intelligence in San Francisco. So I've got some time on
you
the
do.
Road. Yeah,
you do.
SANS basically twisted my arm a little bit.
Do you know the saying of Madrid?
No, I do not.
Madrid me mata. Madrid will kill me. Madrid will kill me.
Oh, Madrid will kill me.
Because, you know, you don't have dinner until 9 and then you're out doing things, and then you wake up early in the morning, you do it again and again and again.
I'm going to try not to do that. Yeah. I would prefer for Madrid not to kill me. That seems like a much better plan.
Apparently, it's a natural historical thing.
Hey, you know, I'm going to be careful there. Thank you for the warning.
So, yeah. It's fun. It's a lot of fun.
I've never been there before. Looking forward to it.
Yeah.
Checking a box. Right. So, yes. Definitely.
Very cool.
Awesome. Well, hey, thanks for putting on this Forensics Lunch. I'm super happy to be here at Enfuse and again with the awesome folks here.
Yeah, no, thanks for coming on, Jake. It's always good to see you.
Thank you for your time.
Yeah. Matt, thank you too, by the way.
Now, for those of you watching, if you have questions for Jake, you know, I know there's always a delay between what we say and what you see and what you hear. Jake's going to hang out for a little bit.
Yeah, I'm hanging out right here.
Yeah,
I'm not going anywhere.
And so, you know, he'll be here. But we do have another guest.
Hi. my name is Dmitry Samin. I'm founder of Passware. We make Password Kit Forensic. The decryption tool for
want to make sure they can hear you.
Investigators. All right.
So you don't know how loud this room is if you're watching online, and these mics are really good at tuning out everything as long as you get it right on. Your Passware. That's your company.
Yes.
We use your stuff all the time.
How do you like it?
I like it a lot. One of my favorite things to do, and one of the ways that people think I do magic, is when I use the support that you have to take in a hibernation file, look in the LSAS process, and give me plain text passwords.
Wow. That's what we are trying to do. So
yes.
We are clearly seeing that encryption is on the rise now.
Yes.
And it's really getting a big challenge for computer investigators. So we are trying to find ways around encryption, not only, you know, making brute force attacks faster, but also doing live memory image analysis, acquiring recovery encryption keys from the cloud, and just generally trying to provide the most efficient tools for investigators to get data decrypted.
Now, one of the things I've always liked about Passware is you guys have kind of, say, devoted to what you do.
We are. We really try to listen to the feedback from our customers and try to deliver the best product.
Well, yeah, because it's easy to get distracted by a new idea or a new... like, why don't you do this? And you're like, maybe I could.
Well, I mean, even at this moment, Password Kit Forensic supports over 280 different file types.
That's amazing.
And, I mean, even trying to keep up with all the new versions of operating systems, of, you know, how Apple changes encryption in iTunes backups. It's a real challenge.
It's constant.
Yeah, it's constant.
Now, I think the only thing we have going for us is that usually we don't see the evidence until a couple months after the changes happen.
Yes, that's true.
I mean, they have to have enough time to commit a crime.
But, I mean, at the same time, if we look to doing cloud acquisition.
Yes.
I mean, if Apple changes some of the protocols, we need to come up with an update pretty fast, otherwise.
Oh, yeah. That's much more critical, time-sensitive. So, I didn't realize you guys were doing iCloud now.
Yeah, we do.
Really?
Yeah.
That's okay. Cool. And is it straight through with the Apple ID and password? Or
Both. So, you can use Apple ID and password, or you can use authentication token.
Nice.
But... speaking of iCloud, one of the recent features in Password Kit Forensic is the ability to extract a file vault 2 encryption key from the iCloud.
Really?
And not only from the iCloud, if you have iPhone backup encryption key for your desktop file vault 2 volume is there in the backup.
Okay, now for those who don't understand how cool that is, let's take a step back. So we all know that Apple removed their ability, and some people say supposedly, but their ability to unlock a phone so you can get it. But most people may have been missing the point that iCloud backups are controlled and accessible by Apple, and that a legal request in the right way with the right authority can actually get you into that account no matter what, because they maintain that service. So if you can get the iCloud account, you can get the desktop File Vault 2 password that is associated with that.
Exactly.
That's awesome. No, I mean, seriously, because we've made jokes about this before, but the worst person to investigate is a dead person.
Yeah. Exactly. They will never tell you the password.
I know, right? They're jerks. So, that's amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah. Now, when you're saving down the data, I know other tools that we use to do this right now, putting into an iTunes kind of style backup. Are you doing something similar? Or
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. We do.
Now, one question I had, someone asked me, is that how it's natively being stored on the Apple side, or is that just how we're ingesting it when we take it down?
You know, it's different for different versions of iOS operating system. But we download in native format, and we decrypt it so to make it accessible for further investigation.
Very cool. Very cool. Now, that's probably one of the highlights of today, actually. That's going to solve a lot of problems. Because, you know, we just got done talking to Steve about 5Vault 2 and how you have to make sure you have a distribution that supports it, and that when you're acquiring it, you see it correctly, and being able to pass in the credentials. And then when you're dealing with it, it's just like, you know, any other full disk encrypted disk, you're just stuck with an encrypted image.
Oh, yeah.
So having, you know, some hope that there is a way to get access to that, you know, even if your person is dead or completely uncooperative, that's pretty amazing. What else you got? That's a big lead on.
No, I mean, we are always trying to find ways, you know, not to... brute force attack is certainly one of the options, but for the recent full disk encryption software like Veracrypt, I mean, trying to brute force attack against Veracrypt is painful there. So password cracking speed on a single PC, even with a GPU, is just below 10 passwords per
second. Yeah, yeah.
And that's why, I mean, doing memory image analysis is important. If you are able to capture memory image properly and then find encryption keys there,
yep.
You can get this drive decrypted in a few minutes.
So Sarah says, are there any particular iCloud settings need to be set to get that? So I guess...
Just default settings.
Default settings. There you go, Sarah. Sorry, that's still really cool. Now, I know you're parsing memory, looking for known encryption keys, knowing for known block formats of different ones. What else are you doing with memory now?
Quite a lot of stuff. if we are speaking about Mac OS,
let's start there. Yeah, let's start there.
We can, if a user has logged in at least once into a computer, we can extract his account password from memory.
Yeah, see, that's interesting because supposedly it's encrypted now.
It is encrypted.
Oh, really?
It is encrypted.
But that isn't stopping.
No. And I mean, this password is critically important. It gives you access to FileVault 2 as
well,
and gives you access to keychain.
Yes.
And all the passwords that are stored in the keychain.
Yes. So. What else you got? This is great. No, just, I mean, just so you know, there's no real time limit here.
Now, also, you can find encryption keys for Office documents.
Yes, of course.
Stuff like that.
Yep. So. Now, what about on the Windows side?
It's more or less the same.
Okay.
So encryption keys for BitLocker, authentication tokens for iCloud.
Yep. Very nice.
All the similar stuff. But it's really very important to teach first responders how to acquire memory properly.
Yes.
Because,
yes.
I mean, if a user comes in with just a thumb drive with encrypted TrueCrypt or VeroCrypt volume, It's a big challenge.
No, it's real.
Yeah.
So, do you have a particular memory acquisition method that you would recommend then for people?
So, our recommendation is just try to do a warm boot attack.
Yep.
Just take any good Linux imager.
Yep.
And boot the computer with this thumb drive.
Yep. And just dump it as quick as you can.
Yeah.
And so for those who don't know, warm boot is what we were talking about a little earlier with Steve, where if you can quickly reboot the system, overwrite as little memory as possible when you load up your live distro, and then just image RAM before the contents are cleared.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fascinating when you think about it. Yeah. You know?
And I mean, I'm also very excited to see how fast the GPUs are evolving.
Yes.
So it's amazing. I think NVIDIA is doing an amazing job.
Mm-hmm.
So the latest GTX 1080s are just screaming.
Yes. And they just released a Ti.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Ti's even better.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I have a 1070 in this.
Wow.
Which is why it looks so nice today.
But it also gets only 5 minutes of battery.
No, it'll do about 2 hours. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was much.
No. It's a Sager.
I mean, using GPUs is always a challenge.
Yes.
Because if you try to put 8 GPUs in a single box, you might run into problems with cooling, with power supply. So.
Yes. So this is actually something we've asked other people who are actually developing, you know, especially the distributed capacitor cracking kind of features is, you know, people obviously use things differently than you expect them to.
Oh, yeah.
Well, how would you expect that someone would actually do a kind of a clustered setup of distributed attack agents? Like, what would you say is that they should be doing to get kind of the best results?
Well, you know, this really depends on how much knowledge, how much technical resources are there. I mean, probably the easiest solution might be to go with Guidance TPR.
Mm-hmm.
We've partnered with Guidance quite a lot of years ago.
Yes.
Started with encryption detection, stuff like that, but we've worked with them for the last 2 years to make TPR systems very, very easy to use. You just buy a box, put it in your mm-hmm. network, and
yeah.
you're all done.
Nice.
If there is at least some technical knowledge, you can go to a reseller like DI or
yeah.
Sumori.
Yeah.
And buy a box with GPUs.
Yeah.
But then you'll need to, you know, to understand that the typical life cycle of a GPU is approximately, I'd say, around 3 years. So
yeah, yeah.
After that time, you'll basically
yeah,
need to
replace
them
again.
Out.
Yep, yep. And then you have to deal with the cooling factor and
yes.
power distribution.
Yes.
And
I mean, even if you buy like 8 new GPUs
yeah.
in 3 years.
Yeah.
They might be not compatible with your motherboard.
Absolutely.
Or, you know, power requirements
yep.
might be higher. So
yep.
it's a challenge.
Yeah.
But if you have really, really good engineering in-house, you can buy a box, stuff
mm-hmm.
in 8 GPUs, make sure that cooling is adequate.
Yep. So what I've been seeing people doing is, have you seen these, it's not really a case, it's more of a holder and just aluminum rails where it's kind of an open factor and then
yeah,
they get PCI risers to expand and
yeah, that's one of
it's
the
crazy.
Options. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, cooling is really, really important. So we've seen customers just complaining, okay, your software would freeze.
Right.
And after, you know, a couple of emails, we just see that GPUs are overheating.
Yes.
And you could fry those. And
so,
that's really expensive.
So I think what we're saying is that we need to make sure that there is an offsite pastor crack facility in either Alaska or northern Alberta.
Yes. clearly not in Las Vegas.
No, not in Las Vegas. It was funny because I was talking to one person and he explained that he liked to run his pastard cracker in the winter.
yes.
It keeps him warm.
But, I mean, it gets really noisy.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
It is.
Very cool. Is there anything else that's coming out? There's Passware Forensic.
Passwordgate Forensic. Well, we just try to push new updates
yep.
to our customers
yep.
as fast as we can. We've been able to keep with 4 major releases per year
mm-hmm.
for the last, I don't know, 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
So we also try to make software updates painless for
yeah.
our customers.
Yeah.
You just, it all happens automatically.
I've never had an issue.
I mean, if you're running a cluster of 100 machines, the software would push the update to all those machines.
I've never had to do that. That's cool, though. And anything else? Any other big things coming up for you, or next place you're going to be at a show that people can come and meet you at? Or
we'll be exhibiting at Technosecurity in Myrtle Beach
in
just a few weeks.
Yeah, are you guys going to the San Antonio one as well?
Not here.
Okay, cool. Well, Dmitry,
thank you.
It was a pleasure. So for those who don't know, it's password.com.
Yes, that's right. Passwordgate Forensic.
Yep. And there'll be a link down below for those watching the recording. We use it. I think most people use it. It's constantly updated. Does exactly what it says it's going to do.
Yeah, I mean, we are seeing a spike of interest in
yep.
Passwordgate Forensic now
well,
due to know, full disk encryption being on by default.
Full disk, and then our other problem now that we're dealing with is the data protection API from Windows 7 forward.
Yeah.
Yeah, where now you have individual files on a non-encrypted Windows disk that are just are being encrypted, and it's the developer opting in, so it's not even like it's a user choice. Yeah. Yep.
So thank you very much for having me here.
Thanks for coming on. It was great. Davida says San Antonio is not as cool as Myrtle Beach. I disagree. The tacos are way better in San Antonio.
But the beach itself.
yeah. It's true. I mean, the beach is nice.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I'm hooked on Mexican food, so. Oh.
All right. Thank you so much,
guys.
Yeah. Thank you.
So, Jake, that was interesting. Some of the things that just came out there.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah. No, that's. Might be changing how I approach a couple things.
I'm excited. I am excited.
Now, I can't... Now, on the Mac side, I think probably one of the reasons that some waves have problems with Macs is that they're not, you know, every case.
Right. I mean, it's for most environments. Now, I'll tell you, too, that we see a lot of Macs in are both legal and medical, right?
Yes.
Every doctor is walking
yes.
around with a Mac and an iPad.
Yep.
And every lawyer gets to pick whatever they want because they're lawyers, right? So...
I've said this before. If you don't understand the power of the legal community, then you don't realize that they invented an industry called e-discovery to take perfectly good native data and convert it to something else so they can read it anytime they choose to.
Outstanding. Yeah, totally. Hey, did you see the case recently? I tweeted this out. Speaking of e-discovery, where they asked for text messages, but they didn't specify the format. And so the firm responding, and I don't know whether or not, to be fair, I don't know whether or not this was an intentional thing, like they didn't know how to image the phones or couldn't image the phones.
They took pictures.
What they did is they took pictures of the text messages on the screen of the phone. And I'm like, that is epically awesome from a burying your
So let's talk about that from true perspectives then. Because there is the non-technical aspect, which is maybe that's the only way they knew how to get the text messages.
It's possible.
And they just took pictures, and there's a lot of smaller firms that are like that. And then there's the very technical reason.
Oh, yes.
Which is,
bury them in data.
How can I produce the messages without any of the metadata or give you a chance at the deleted messages?
How can I make it as difficult as possible for you to... Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I mean, I remember I had a case back in... I mean, it was long 2004, where the other side... we asked for their logs from their web server, and
they print them?
20 banker's boxes.
That's awesome.
Of printed... No, it'd be even best. It was cut off midway through. So we got, like, half of the log for each log entry and 20 boxes of this.
Oh, so like it was, you had to put the... Oh,
No. They didn't give us the other half.
Oh, they didn't give you the other half. Oh, that's brilliant.
Sometimes there's a technical explanation, as in like they just didn't know what they were doing. You know, they're looking for more guidance. They thought they were acceptable. And other times it's what we call a strategy.
Sure. And look, very strategic in that case, because that makes the log analysis darn near impossible.
Oh, it was definitely impossible because the part that cracked the case was on the other half of the page that we got later.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, that's... how would you... Oh, it's ridiculous, man. And look, if you're going to do that while you're dropping the stuff off, now, of course, I'm not encouraging anything here, but if you're going to do that, I encourage you to take a rental so no one keys your car, right?
Yep.
So as you're carrying in the many boxes of whatever, or use a courier service, it's well worth it. But your daily driver, man, don't want somebody slashing your tires and all that. And if you get a rental, buy the insurance, right? Good move there.
Yeah. True. Yeah. Very true.
Yeah, that e-discovery, I mean, look, I'm not going to knock e-discovery. There's obviously a reason for
it. No, they're...
But the
they serve
amount
a purpose.
Of legal wrangling that goes on there.
Yes, yeah. Well, I mean, they have a whole set of procedures, and there's the Sedona group now to try to create standards and best practices for dealing with it, and there's huge volumes of data. I mean, the stuff that we end up analyzing is such a small bit of the actual case.
Oh, absolutely.
Thank God for that.
Yeah, well, you know, oftentimes, too, and this is something that, you know, that a lot of folks don't realize, and I get this in some cases where... You know, folks come back and they say you requested all of this data and then you didn't look at it.
Yep.
It's like, yeah, but we've got one. In most cases, I have one shot to do.
Yep.
Right. As the trial approaches, I've got one shot to do discovery, basically. And in that case, I'm going to go ahead and ask for everything I can conceivably think of needing.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
Now, look, if I find something unique there that then says, and I couldn't have predicted that it would need me to pivot into this other data source, then I've got a pretty good odds to go back. But if I request first a little bit, and I look at that, and I'm like, well, there's nothing there. Better ask for more. You're not getting that. That's
no.
not, the cases don't work
yeah,
that way.
No. And, no.
But companies, you know, some of my clients sometimes get a little antsy about, they're like, mm-hmm. we had to pay for this discovery, and
yep.
then you use like 10% of it.
Yep.
90% of it was wasted. And it's like, no, yeah. believe me, right? If it hadn't been, I didn't know which 10% it was going to be in, by
right.
the way,
right?
If
right.
I'd known, believe me, I wouldn't have asked for all of it.
Well,
right?
And, so. You know, it's funny because one of the things that's supposed to be done now as part of the federal rules is that the party's supposed to get together and actually disclose where all this data should be.
Right. Yep.
It just doesn't really seem to happen.
No, come on,
I mean,
on, man.
I had one person, I said, can I get a data map? Because what they're supposed to exchange. And they gave me a spreadsheet saying, these are some of the servers that contain data.
Right.
And I'm like, that doesn't help me.
Exactly useless for
yes.
me, right? That's a,
yes.
yeah, totally useless. I will tell you, though, that, you know, when we're doing, coming back to the incident response piece, right?
Yep.
As we do incident response and, you know, in some cases auditing, shoot me, auditing. But, you know, incident response and auditing, a lot of times what we end up dealing with is that people don't know where their data's at. So
this is very true.
So to go ask somebody for a data map, I find that we're creating those for clients a lot.
No question.
I would imagine that in most cases, they don't have a good coherent data map to give you.
No. And it's a huge effort to be able to figure out where your stuff is and start creating a program to manage it and determine where it should be stored and all the rest. There's no question.
But you will always be better off in security for it. And when the inevitable lawsuit happens, because
yep.
it will happen,
yep.
right? It will cost you a heck of a lot less to respond to that e-discovery request than it will otherwise, right? Not to mention
yep.
the risk, right? The
yep.
big risk with e-discovery, and we haven't even talked about this,
mm-hmm.
is the you don't actually turn over the data that you were requested to turn over. And there's two kind of places that falls in, right?
Yep.
One is the willful negligence type thing. I didn't really try, therefore
yep.
I, right?
Yep.
And the other one is the, you know, is the, I tried and oops, we missed something. The latter case is not a big deal in my experience. But
well, I've had the third case, which is, oh, you asked the right question finally.
Right. Oh, you asked the right question. Oh, the 50 questions thing, yep. Hey, have you seen Discovery Sloth?
No.
Are you kidding?
No.
We haven't talked about Discovery Sloth?
No.
Go hit discoverysloth.com, right? So discoverysloth.com. This is actually something that one of my Rendition InfoSec people put together last year for
okay.
April Fools. And it is absolutely epic. I laughed out loud hysterically the first time I saw this. And it is a fake, again, it's an April Fools joke.
Yeah.
We don't actually sell the software. even though some people probably want the software. It's fake e-discovery software. It's single-threaded.
Yeah.
It's intentionally throttled. Has an adjustable error rate. It even has a built-in, a separate module, an add-on module called MethChimp that you can use basically to help corrupt some data during the acquisition process. So it's software that will help you look like you're, you know, obviously can fake ad for software that will help you look like you're complying without actually complying.
That's
right?
Awesome.
And it's still online. So I was going to take it down this year, and I'm like, how can we take this down? This is just too good. So
that's going to be cited in some case soon.
I thought that we were. I seriously thought we talked about this. I guess
no.
I guess
no.
Not.
That's pretty great.
Oh well. Hey, I'm glad we got an e-discovery then. And by the way, that's the only time you're ever going to hear me say the words, "I'm glad we got an e-discovery then."
Yeah, no. I mean, that's the reason that we started a company and do all this is because the company we used to work for back before 2005 told us one day that they wanted to stop doing forensics and just do e-discovery. So
yeah,
just the threat of being having to do it full time without ever a chance to do anything else was enough to make us leave.
Oh yeah, for sure.
And it's not a knock to you if you're doing discovery right now. If that's the job that you wanted or the job that you're happy with, that's great. There's a ton of work for you, my friend. Let me tell you, and it's never going to end. But for me, obviously, I'm more interested in forensics.
Yeah, and also, please don't make it sound like, or please don't, I guess I made it sound like, but please don't take it like, you know, I think that e-discovery is horrible. There's a place for it. It's certainly an important job. It's not my passion.
Yep,
right?
Exactly.
And I have people on my staff who are big e-discovery nerds, and it is their passion. And hey, that's it. Rock on. That's why I hired you,
yep.
right? So,
yep.
winning. But, yeah.
All right. Well, Matt?
Good stuff. That's good stuff. That's all, I mean... I got nothing to follow.
We've had a good week here.
Yeah. It's been fun. Infuse is always a good time.
It is.
Definitely my favorite part about it is getting to hang out with people
yep.
like Jake. And,
yep.
Oh, I like coming out here and hanging out with people like you. That's
cool.
Awesome.
Aw, look at this.
Yeah. It's just such a great place to meet up with your friends that are in the industry.
Again, we said this before, it's the largest conference
yes.
for forensics.
So you really
and
can't
e-discovery.
Beat that.
Yep.
Yeah, it's really cool to see what people are doing
yep.
with the OS, the memory.
Yes.
That's awesome.
DeepHard Guy says, lots of money eDiscovery, forensics more fun, eDiscovery is more money. This is absolutely true. And every case needs eDiscovery, not every case needs forensics. So there you go. But with that, we will be live again tomorrow at noon Pacific. That's 2 p.m. Central, 3 p.m. Eastern. We're going to do our last broadcast here at Infuse. We're not going to be here in the convention hall. This is closing down today at 4:30. So if you are one of the people who have told me this, who is actually watching this in their hotel room, you should know that this is your last chance to come by this afternoon and say hi, get some stickers. And talk, because tomorrow we're going to do this in the media room and have on another set of guests, including Ashley Hernandez from Guidance, talking about what's new and coming with InCase and some other fun guests.
Well, that'll be exciting.
No, well, it's nice to hear from the people responsible for the
serious
product. Yeah,
absolutely.
Same here.
Yeah.
So until then, thanks for tuning in. Thanks especially for those of you who watch live. I don't know if you're getting tired of a daily broadcast at this point. No, I mean, it's a lot. It's a lot to keep up with. So we're going to do it again Thursday. And, surprise, we're going to actually have another broadcast on Friday. So there's going to be 4 broadcasts this week. Don't expect this again until next year.
Dave, my friend, you are a machine.
You know, we've joked about this before, but the reason that we've kept this going so long is how little effort we have to spend in getting ready for it, because all we're doing is talking about forensics, and it's an easy conversation to have, so it's not like I have to devote like a day of show prep or something to go read through the notes and understand what we're going to talk about. But the other side, something that Matt and I just realized today, is that July of this year will mark 4 years.
4 years.
Yes.
We're also coming up on our 100th episode
Yes.
as well.
Yeah, 100 wow. episodes of the Forensic Lunch. So,
wow.
I didn't think
so
it was going to happen.
So submit your suggestions now for the 100th episode surprise.
Yes.
I'm and voting for Dave and Speedos.
Preferably things not involving wardrobe changes. But until tomorrow, or until later, thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.